Let us get started for today. Last week, we started to introduce some function spaces. And today, we will speak a little bit more about the relationship between these spaces. And we will also deal with operators on the spaces. So again, function spaces. And the focus will be on the general spaces LP of R. And as we will see at the end of the first lecture, one of these spaces plays a special role, namely the space L2 of R. So I put that here also. So last week, we already defined a lot of spaces. So let's just repeat the definition of the spaces. So we had a space of continuous function with compact support. So this was denoted CCR. So this is a set of functions f going from R into C with the property that the function is continuous. And the reason that we put the C here is that we require the function to have compact support. So we remember that compact support means that the function only is non-zero on a certain interval. So that means we have a function that goes like maybe something like this, and then at some point it goes down and it is equal to zero, and here also it goes down and it's equal to zero, and then it continues to be zero from the rest of the interval. And we had a space C0R, which again is a set of functions from R into C. Again, it is a space of continuous functions. But instead of requiring that the function has compact support, we just request that the function converges to zero when x goes to plus minus infinity. So we have the condition that f of x goes to zero as x converges to plus minus infinity. So this means we don't have this picture anymore. We just have that the function is going maybe like this. It is getting closer to zero, but it does not need to reach the value zero. And then we have the LP spaces. So we had LP of R. And let's state the definition for P larger than or equal to 1 less than infinity. If you look in the book, you'll see there's also a definition for P equal to infinity, but this is not defined in terms of an integral. And this is a space that I'll not speak about at the lecture, but there will be some exercises where you have to work with that. So for P less than infinity, this is the set of functions F, again, going from R into C, with the property that if you take the integral from minus infinity to infinity of F of x in absolute value to the power P, dx, we get something finite. And I did not speak much about this space at the last lecture. We spoke about the space L1, but not so much about the general spaces LP. But you had exercises about it at the problem session. So you proved a theorem which says that this space is actually a Banach space. So first of all, it is a norm space, and then with respect to that norm, we actually have a Banach space. So it is a Banach space and remember, we always have to specify the norm. So this is with respect to the norm, and the way it was defined was similar to what we did for the sequence spaces. So we have that this expression is finite for functions in LP, and then we just take the p root of that. So we define the norm as f p. This is the integral of f of x to the power p dx from minus infinity to infinity, and then we take the p root of that. I don't know if all of you observed it, but there's actually one complication in the proof that this is a norm. So if you really went into all details with the definition, you see, the definition of a norm, we have it here. So let's go through what you had to prove. And first of all, you know, you have to prove that these double bars give us a mapping from the space into the real numbers. So this is actually satisfied with this expression, because whenever you put in a function that belongs to LP, then by definition, you know that this integral is finite. That means this actually gives us a number. So this is perfect. That the norm is greater than or equal to zero, this is also something you get from the definition, because this is an integral over positive values. So this will give something that is greater than or equal to zero. That you can multiply with an alpha and you can take it out, this is something you check just by putting in the alpha here, then it ends up here, and then you get it out here to the power p, and you take the p root, and therefore it comes out with alpha absolute value. So this is also okay. And the last part, this turns out to be, this is the triangle inequality. This is one of the famous inequalities that we have in one of the theorems at the beginning of the book. So there are no problems so far, but you see there's something that is stated here also. And I skip that. First, if the function is equal to zero, then the norm is equal to zero. This is something you get, because if you take the function and it is equal to zero, this means all function values are zero. This means you have zero, and therefore the integral is zero. So if the function is zero, then you get that the norm is zero. But there's a slight problem with the last part of the definition, namely the arrow going from here to here. So in other words, if the norm is equal to zero, can we really conclude that the function is equal to zero? Did any of you think about that at the problem session last week? Yeah, Andreas, I know you have measure theory, so what do you say now?
Yeah, but you could think of a function that were different from zero, finite in many points, or infinite in many points, but say one in rational numbers and zero in irrational numbers. Definitely measure zero, but it wouldn't be zero everywhere.
Yes. So let me repeat what you said, and let me just make it a little bit easier. So you say it could be that we take a function that is not equal to zero everywhere, and that the integral is still equal to zero. And you said something about that you could take finitely many points, or you could even take infinitely many points. But let's take the simplest possible example. If you take a function, we do not want it to be the zero function. So let's take something that is zero all the way here, and then there's just one point where it takes another value. And then it is zero again for the rest. So all of us agree that this is not the zero function, because there is a point where the function is not zero. But nevertheless, if you take this function and you put it in here, you'll get the value zero out, because the integral cannot distinguish what happened in a single point. So if you make the integral over a function which just has one point where it is non-zero, and it is zero at the rest of the points, then you still get zero. So that means, strictly speaking, the implication from here till here is actually not satisfied with this definition. All the other conditions are satisfied, but exactly that one is not satisfied. There's a way to avoid that problem, and this is what is called measure theory. And the measure theory, there are some of you, even also some of your instructors, some of your the people who are helping us at the problem session, they have a special course on measure theory right now. So if you wanted to do the measure theory, we had to spend 5 ECTS points just doing that. Measure theory is the only part that we actually needed in mathematics for, but where I decided to skip that part. So we will not go into any measure theory. I just tell you that there is actually a slight problem going from here and to here. We don't have that satisfied. So what measure theory is doing is that it somehow identifies functions which are equal almost everywhere. So this means this function, which just has a single point where it is not equal to zero, this will be identified with the function that is equal to zero everywhere. And this sounds like some magic tricks which are not really mathematics, but if you take measure theory, you will see that it actually works, and you can do it in a completely strict mathematical way. So there's a way to avoid the problem that we see here. So the short version of what I'm saying now is, this is actually a norm, but what we have to do is, instead of speaking about functions, we speak about so-called equivalence classes of functions, where we say functions are equal or they are equivalent if they are equal almost everywhere. This will never disturb us. Those of you who want these details, ask me when I come to the problem session. I'll be very happy to discuss that with you. I just don't want to do it here. So we can come back to that. Okay, I have one more question for you. Now, we have seen these two spaces of continuous functions, and we have seen the LP spaces. Which one of them would you rather work with? What would you prefer? Of course, you cannot know what to answer, so I just want to know, how do you look at it? What do you think would be the most convenient to work with of these three spaces? Rune?
You say, yes. It's always nice to have continuous functions, and if they're compact, then you can analyze the whole function.
So you say you would prefer to work with the first base because you like to work with continuous functions, and you also like compact support because then you can handle everything. You cannot handle everything if the function is spread out over the entire line, but you can do it if it has compact support. I agree completely about that. So I would prefer to work with that space as well. Now, what we will do is to discuss, we have one favorite among the spaces. Why do we have to introduce all these spaces then? So what are the advantages and what are the disadvantages of these spaces? So let's start with a nice space, C, C, R. So actually, I want to just to repeat what you said. So I think this is convenient because the assumptions are realistic for applications. The assumption that we have compact support is realistic for applications. And why do I say that this is realistic for applications? This is because if you are in an applied situation, there will always be a starting point and there will be an end point. You look at a certain experiment, it starts somewhere and it stops somewhere. You switch on a certain power contact and you switch it off again later. So this assumption is very realistic for applications. This is a good thing, but there are also some bad things. And we want something that is nice from the point of view of applications, but we also want something that is nice from the point of view of mathematics. And we know that this is not a Banach space. So this is actually something that we proved in details last week. And also, we could put it as an advantage that the functions are continuous. It is nice to work with continuous functions. But what happens if you are in a certain application and then some functions come up that are not continuous? Then you cannot deal with them within the framework of either of these two spaces. So it is nice that the space deals with continuous functions, but it is also a restriction from that point of view. So this is again something I will formulate with a but at the beginning. So the problem is not all functions in real life are continuous. So you can just think about what happened when you switch on the button to something. There's a certain power switch that goes on. Before you switch it on, there's no voltage in the circuit, but then you switch it on and then suddenly it jumps up to a certain value. So this is just an example of a function that is not continuous. So what happened with the rest of the spaces? So we have the C, 0, R. One nice thing about this space is we proved that this is a Banach space. And the norm is the infinity norm, the supremum norm. So this is again something we proved last week. Also, the assumption, if you look at it, the assumption is that the function is 10 to 0. I also think this is a realistic assumption. In particular, if you are looking at something in application that actually turns out to have compact support, then this is also contained here. So if you have compact support, this means the function is 0 outside a certain interval, then of course you can also say that it goes to 0. So it is still contained in this space. So again, we can say the assumptions are realistic for applications. But again, we can also say we still have the same problem as above, that not all functions are continuous. So what about the final class of spaces? You see, here I defined all the LP spaces. Let's just discuss one of them. Let's just discuss L1. So the good thing about L1 is, first of all, this is again a Banach space. Because this is exactly what we stated here. All of these spaces are Banach spaces. So now it is a Banach space, not with respect to the same norm as here. Before we had the infinity norm, now we have the norm on L1. Another good thing is this space contains functions that are not continuous. And maybe this is something you did not think about, but it is easy to make pictures of functions that are in L1 that are not continuous. So you can, for example, just take the characteristic function for a certain interval and then put it 0 here, put it 0 here. Then you have an example of a non-continuous function which is in L1. Andreas?
Don't need sophistication on integral.
I cannot hear what you say.
You say it need not be continuous. Don't need sophistication on integral.
The Riemann integral also deals with functions that are piecewise continuous.
Yeah, exactly.
So therefore this is okay.
Yeah. Shouldn't you sort of split the integral up in intervals where it's actually continuous?
That's true. This is what you're doing in Riemann integration. That's true.
Yeah.
Yes. So what else can we say about L1? Again, I will say the assumptions in L1 and actually in all of the LP spaces, they are realistic for applications. If you think about something that is absolutely not realistic for application, that would be a function that just grows when you let, for example, x goes to infinity. A certain signal that just explodes for x going to infinity. This is something that cannot describe anything in the real life. But this is something that is excluded in all these spaces, because if you want this integral to be zero, to be finite, then it more or less forces the function f to have some decay when you go to plus minus infinity. It is not allowed to explode, because if it explodes, then the value of the integral will also explode and give the value infinity. So again, you can say the assumptions are realistic for applications. So now you see, now you have a space that actually, there's no but so far. It satisfies all the conditions where we had but in the past. You know, when you get something, you always want more. And here you can say, now you have a Banach space. What about having a Hilbert space? Because this is even nicer than to have a Banach space. It is good that the norm is coming from an inner product. And this is where we have to introduce a but for the space L1, because L1 is not a Hilbert space. So what we'll do in just a couple of minutes is to go back to all the LP spaces and then we will identify one of these spaces, which is a Hilbert space. And I think you can almost guess which one of them will be a Hilbert space. So we will do that in just a few minutes. Before we do that, now we have identified a nice space. Why did we need to introduce all the other spaces? Because we have observed that they have good properties, but maybe they are not the best spaces for applications. It turns out that we agreed that we would actually like to work with functions in this space, but they're just not enough for us because we need to work with spaces like L1, L2, or the other LP spaces. But there's a good reason that we introduce these spaces. Namely, if we take any function that belongs to L1 or L2 or any of the LP spaces, it turns out that it can always be approximated arbitrarily well by functions that are sitting here. So the reason that we introduce these is that all functions in LP of R can be approximated by functions that are in this space. And when I say approximated, it actually means that you can get arbitrarily close to any function with a function that is in CCR. So this is something that we will not do now. We will come back to this point in just a few weeks, but there's a statement that I want to put for you. And it introduces a word that we did not deal with so far. And this is that the space CCR is, and now you get the new word, dense in. And now I could actually say LP here, but because we are dealing with L1 now, I'll just say L1 of R. So the question is, what does this word mean? And I just explained it to you as a warm-up for something that is coming later. It means that if we pick an arbitrary function sitting in this space, and now we want to approximate that function, that means we want to get close to this function within a distance of epsilon, we have to define what this means, then the statement is that for any choice of epsilon, we can actually find a function there's a function g that belongs to CCR such that, and how do we want to approximate the functions? How do we want to approximate a function L1? We want to do it in terms of the norm that is associated with the space. That means we want to find a function that is close to this function measured in the norm of this space. And this is exactly what this g is doing. So the norm of f minus g measured in the one norm will be smaller than the given epsilon. So given any function f and given any epsilon larger than zero, we can find a continuous function with compact support such that the norm difference is smaller than epsilon. So this means that whenever you are working with L1 functions, you can always approximate them by continuous functions having compact support. And we are coming back to this in week 8. So there's a whole topic called approximation theory. And we are doing that in week 8. So just to give you an example where you can use this, you know, sometimes if you have a function of two variables and you have to integrate it, then you integrate with respect to one variable and you integrate with respect to the other variable. There are some cases where you need to be very careful whether you first integrate with respect to x and then with respect to y, or first with respect to y or then with respect to x. It turns out that for functions in this space, for functions that are continuous with compact support, you can always exchange the order of integration. It does not make any difference. So that means if you want to exchange the order for a given function in L1, technically what you can do is first you approximate this function by a continuous function with compact support where you can exchange as much as you want. And then as the next step, you take the function in L1 and you approximate it by a continuous function of compact support. And then using that, you can make some manipulations to show that you can also exchange the order for this given function in L1. So this is just a warm-up. We are doing all these details later in week 8, but now you can see that there's a reason that we are speaking about the space of continuous functions with compact support, because they are nice and because they can be used to approximate all the functions in L1 or L2 or any of the LP spaces. So let's now go back to what is missing. We had this point here. We do not have a Hilbert space. What is a Hilbert space? So we know this is a vector space with an inner product. So we have this bracket notation for the inner product. So first of all, we have a vector space with an inner product, and then we also require that we actually have a Banach space with respect to the norm that is associated with the inner product. And you remember the way you come to the norm based from the inner product is you take the inner product of an element with itself to the power half, then you have the norm on the space. And we also remember that for the sequence spaces, we had exactly one Hilbert space, L2 of n. This is a Hilbert space. So already now, we have seen a lot of cases where the sequence spaces and the function spaces have very similar properties. So I think it will not be a surprise to you that the next statement will be that the function space L2 of R is also a Hilbert space. So the space L2 of R is a Hilbert space. And when you say something is a Hilbert space, you always have to say with respect to which inner product. So you remember, for the space L2, what you had to do to take the inner product between a sequence xk and a sequence yk was to take the sum of all values xk times the complex conjugated of yk. What we are doing here is the same for the function space. We say that the inner product is the inner product between f and g. This is now, instead of the sum, this is the integral from minus infinity to infinity. And instead of xk times yk complex conjugated, what we get here is the function value f of x times the function value g of x complex conjugated dx. So let's prove this statement. And I think by now you know me very well, so you also know what I'll do as the first step. So of course I will show that the inner product is well defined. This is what we always do. So this is always the first step. First, show that the inner product FG is well defined. And you also know that the way to show that an integral is well defined is to calculate the integral of the function with absolute value and show that we get something finite. So we need to look at the integral from minus infinity to infinity of absolute value of f of x, g of x, complex conjugated dx. And then we need to do some manipulations to show that this is finite. The problem with this is that we don't really know anything about the integral of f times g of x, complex conjugated. Because the assumption is that the functions f and g, they will belong to our space. That means they belong to the space L2. So that means the only thing we know about the functions f and g is that if we put in the value 2 for the p, then we have an integral which is finite. So this is not really related to what we want to estimate here. But fortunately, we have a lot of inequalities, and we can use some of them. So these are the inequalities that we are actually proving right now at the problem session. So if you look at these inequalities, you can see that the first one, Hölder's inequality, is doing exactly what we want to do, because it says that the absolute value of a product of a function f of x, g of x, and then bars around, this is smaller than or equal to an integral of f now raised to the power p, and then we have to take the p root of that, times the integral of the function g now raised to a power q, and then the q root of that. And we just have to choose p and q such that 1 divided by p plus 1 divided by q is equal to 1. So the natural thing to do here is to say, let's take p and q equal to 2. So we take Hölder, and we take p equal to q equal to 2. Then this tells us that the integral we want to know something about is smaller than or equal to the integral from minus infinity to infinity, f of x, absolute value to the power 2, dx, all of this to the power a half. And then we do exactly the same with the function g. And by assumption, both of these integrals are finite. That means the product is finite. So that means at the end, we see that this integral is finite. And then we refer to this lemma that is also stated here, lemma 172, which says that if the integral of the absolute value of a function is finite, then the function is integrable, and we even know something about the integral. So by the lemma, now we know that the integral f of x, g of x, complex conjugated dx, from minus infinity to infinity, this is actually well defined. We do not need this inequality that we get out here, the integral which relates the integral of the absolute value to the integral without the absolute value. So I will not state that. We just need this conclusion that this is well defined. Okay, so now the integral is well defined. All what we have to do now is to prove that all the properties of the inner product are satisfied. So let's do that quite fast. So we need to check all the properties 1, 2, and 3 from the definition of an inner product. So let's just do it. So first we have the linearity in the first entrance. That means we need to look at some functions f, g, and h in L2 of R, and some numbers alpha and beta in the complex numbers. So we need to look at what should be the inner product between alpha f plus beta G with H. If you put in the definition of the inner product, this is then the integral from minus infinity to infinity, and then we take the first function, alpha f of x plus beta g of x. All of this we have to multiply it with h of x, complex conjugated dx. And you actually did that in the problem session last week, so you know exactly what you have to do here. You multiply the terms with h of x, and you take alpha out, and you take beta out, and then you see that this is exactly the same as alpha times the integral f of x, h of x, complex conjugated dx, and then the exact similar term with the g of x. And then you look at this, and you say this is exactly the same as alpha f inner product with h plus beta g inner product with h. So this is the third part. For the second one, let's call this first part. I actually don't want to do it. So we just stated f inner product with g. You write it as an integral. You do the complex conjugation, and you see this is g f like this. So the third part, if you look at it, you have to look at the inner product between an element and itself and show that this is positive. So the inner product between f and f. But if you use the definition, this is the integral from minus infinity to infinity, absolute value of f of x to the power 2 dx. And you can see this is positive. And also, you see that the inner product between f and itself being 0, this is the same as this expression being 0. And then in terms of this identification we spoke about just at the beginning of the lecture, we can conclude that f is equal to 0. So that means we have now checked all the properties in the definition of an inner product. So all what is left is to make it completely clear that we are dealing with a Banach space with respect to this norm. So all of this is actually stated already on the board, but let me just repeat it again. So we know that L2 of R, this is a Banach space. With respect to the norm f and 2 norm equal to the integral of f of x to the power 2 dx and then the square root of that. And this norm, this is exactly the norm that comes from the inner product. This norm is exactly, as we saw already here, this norm is exactly the inner product between f and itself to the power a half. So everything is checked now. That means we have proved that L2 of R is actually Hilbert space. So what about the rest of the spaces? This is something that is left to you, actually, at the problem session. So I do not think it is today, but at least at one of the problem sessions or one of the homeworks, we will prove that no other of the spaces LP are Hilbert spaces. So this is actually the only one of the spaces which has this nice property. Are there any of you who want to ask anything? No. Because we will actually continue with something else now. Because now we have the space we want to deal with. And actually, L2 of R will be central for the rest of the course. From now on until week 13, we will deal with the space L2 of R. So what we'll do for the rest of today is to start to actually run exactly the same program as we were running, as we were looking at normal space, Banach spaces. That means we have the space now. Now we want to look at operators on that space. So the rest of the lecture today will be about operators on L2. And maybe you think that several of the operators we have looked at so far have been rather constructed operators, maybe something you did not consider very relevant. I think that the operators we will introduce today on L2, you will think that they are very natural to look at. So let's recall what we have done so far. So let's look at an operator on L2 of R. So we look at a mapping going from L2 R into itself. So let's assume that this is bounded and linear. Then 2 weeks ago, you introduced something called the adjoint operator. So this is an operator T star. You remember, if you go from a Hilbert space H into a Hilbert space H, then T star will also be an operator going from H into itself. And the way it is defined, so maybe now because we speak about L2, I should also write L2 of R here. So remember, the strange thing about this operator is that we never write it down explicitly. We just write down a condition that the operator T star has to satisfy. So the way Mads did it for you 2 weeks ago, let me show you. It is here. The way he defined it for you is that T star is the operator satisfying that if you take the inner product between T acting on element V and an element W, then this should be the same as the inner product between the V and T star of W. That means you do not get a formula that tells you how T star look like. You just get that T star must satisfy a certain property, namely that this equation has to be satisfied. So now we are dealing with the space L2 of R, so if you want to find the adjoint of some operators, we can only refer to that statement. This must be the starting point. So what we must say is that the adjoint operator T star going from L2 into L2, this satisfies and then we can put the same formula, so this is still 4, 13. So what it must satisfy is that the inner product between T, F, and G, this should be the same as the inner product between F, T star G, and this must hold for all elements F and G in the space. So this is how it is stated in the abstract terms, that means in terms of the inner product. What does it mean in terms of L2? If you want to find out what this means, we need to write down what the inner product is. And the inner product is the one we have here. So that means we need to write everything down in terms of this inner product. So you see, what is stated here, the inner product between TF and G, this is now the integral from minus infinity to infinity. And then we have to take the first function, which is t of f. We calculate it in a point x, and then we take, we multiply with g of x complex conjugated dx. And this must be the same as what we have on this side, which is then the integral from minus infinity to infinity. And here we have f of x t star g of x dx, and we have to complex conjugate this. So that means we are somehow looking at this inner product. We are looking at this integral. This is where we have to start. And then we need to do some manipulations somehow to get the t away from f. We need to do some manipulations so t is removed from the f, so we end up having f alone. And then whatever happened to the g, this will then be the t star of g. This is what we have to do in practice. And this is what we'll do after the break on some concrete operators. Before we do that, let's just write down some of the properties we would like to check. So we had some concepts also. We said that an operator T is self-adjoint. If it happened that T is equal to T star. So that means we do these manipulations, and if it turns out that what we have here is not just T star, but this is the same T as the one we had here, then the operator is self-adjoint. And the last one I'll write for you is that we have the concept that T is unitary. And this means that if you look at T and we compose it with the operator T star, then we get the same as if we compose the operators the opposite way around. So we look at T star T, and in both cases we get the identity operator. This is a condition for being unitary. So what we'll do now is we take our break, and then after that I will introduce the three types of operators we look at, and then we calculate the operator T star and we check these properties that are stated here. So that's the program for today. So let's meet again at 2 o'clock.